Okay. Hi everyone. Today we are again back with a new case for the students, medical students. So I am Dr. Saurabh Dixit, a practicing laparoscopic and robotic surgeon from New Delhi. And at Highland Care Multispeciality Hospital, we have started a new initiative of case discussion with the medical students. So we have a case of peripheral vascular disease, and my interns will be presenting you this case. This is a modified version of case presentation where they will give us a summary, they will show us some examination, and then I will try to correct them. I'll also add on some theoretical part for you. So now I will ask my intern to give me the summary of this. So let me introduce to them. He is Dr. Lalit and he is Keshav. They both have also given us a presentation earlier also. So now Lalit, can you give us a summary, brief summary of this patient?
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Myself Lalit Rajat, presenting in case history of 65-year-old male, worker by occupation, Hindu by religion, represented to OPD of Highland Care Multispeciality Hospital on 14 January 2021 with complaint of ulcer on the lateral aspect of the left feet for past 7 days. History taken on 15 January 2021 and presented on the same day. History of present illness. Patient was apparently well 5 years when he started claudication pain in both the legs, ever since progressing. Patient developed ulcer 7 days back and got some treatment from the local clinic, and now ulcer has progressed to gangrene. Gangrene ulcer present on the fifth toe of left leg and lateral malleolus of the left leg. He used to smoke 1 packet beery since 8 years.
Thank you. So that was a summary. So students, as per the summary, it is clear that this patient is having a peripheral vascular disease. This patient, let me tell you, this patient is hypertensive also. This patient is a chronic smoker also. So when a patient is a chronic smoker, the first thing that comes into our mind is a Burgess disease, which is actually aggravated in the winters. But if you see the history pattern of Burgess disease, the age, the Shiyanoya criteria, so the Olin's criteria, which is useful for this, is that the patient should be non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, non-atherosclerotic, and the age profile should be less than 50. The age of this patient, kitne saal ki ho? The age is 65 years. So, and this patient is having hypertension also. Yes or no? We have evaluated about the diabetes. Was there any incident, is there any history of diabetes? So no, this patient is non-diabetic but hypertensive. So most probably this is atherosclerosis induced pain. Now if you see the patient, we will ask the patient about some history. जब चलते फिरते हो तो चलने फिरने के टाइम दर्द होता है
तो उस टाइम में ऐसे भी होता है
दर्द होता है
नहीं उस टाइम नहीं होता
जब थोड़ा सा रास्ता चलने के बाद फिर दर्द शुरू हो जाता है ओके कहां पर दर्द होता है
ये होता है ऐसे
ही यहां पर दर्द होता है सो कैन यू सी द पेशेंट इज गिविंग अस अ क्लासिकल हिस्ट्री ऑफ क्लॉडिकेशन दिस इज नोन एज इंटरमिटेंट क्लॉडिकेशन द पेशेंट वॉक्स एंड ही स्टार्ट्स द वॉक कंफर्टेबली बट एज ही प्रोसीड्स ही डेवलप्स पेन ओवर द काफ So there is pain over the calf and there is pain even in the thigh. So that means the blockage should be at the level of ileal veins, ileal vessel and the femoral. So it may be a case of iliofemoral blockage, which we will evaluate later on. So now let me hand over the case to Keshav. Then again I will keep on coming up with what other points also. Before that I forgot about one point. Ye batao, raat mein dard hota hai aapko?
रात
में दर्द होता है कैसा दर्द होता है
रात में दर्द होता है कि पैर रखने लटकाए रहते
हैं ओहो हो सो कैन यू सी अ ब्यूटीफुल हिस्ट्री द पेशेंट डेवलप्स पेन एट नाइट एंड द पेशेंट डेवलप्स पेन एट नाइट एंड दैट टू एट दिस पॉइंट कैन यू सी व्हाट इज दिस रीजन दिस इज मेटाटार्सोफेलेंजियल जॉइंट्स एंड According to the patient, the pain is so severe that it interrupts the sleep and he has to hang his leg or he walks. Do you know what is this classically known as? Can you people tell me what is this classically known as?
Rest pain.
Rest pain. Very good. This is the pain which is unrelated to exercise. So can you see the disease has progressed from claudication to rest pain also in this patient. The patient sleeps comfortably. No, the sleep is not comfortable. Why? Because of the pain which arises during the night, and this is because the blood circulation when the patient is lying supine is reduced to the limb, and when he is hanging the limb below, that there is dependency in this portion and the blood pools and there is better extraction of oxygen and hence the pain is relieved. Now I will ask my intern Dr. Keshav to show us the important signs of or important features that we should be looking in examination. So Keshav, to you now.
Thank you, sir. First, we will do the examination inspection part. On inspection, we can see there is presence of ichthyosis on the lateral aspect of the left leg. There is presence of dilated intradermal vessels. There is presence of lichen planus on these nails. The patient's skin is so dry that there are no hair follicles. There is diminished subcutaneous tissue, which shows that there are features of ischemia present on the skin. Along with other things, as we can see, there is two ulcers as mentioned earlier, one on the fifth metatarsal and one on the lateral malleolus.
Keshav, can you see any scar or any sign of graft?
No, sir, I cannot see any visible sign of graft or any scar in the patient.
Let me tell you this is a very important point. Whenever a patient comes to you, the patient in a vascular disease, you should always look for some scars or some signs of graft, because many a times these patients are patients of chronic vascular disease and they might have undergone some surgical procedure or an ulcer which has already healed up. So these points are very important in inspection. You look at the site of ulceration, you look at the type of ulceration, you look at the temperature, you look at the marked borders of that ulcer, because many a times you can have a callus tissue developing along the border, which might be indicative of what, a Marzolian ulcer. And again, site is very important. Let me tell you, if it is a venous ulcer, it will be in the medial malleolus region. It's the gator zone. What is the gator zone? This is the ankle, and 10 to 15 centimeter above this area, this is the gator zone. So vascular venous ulcers are here. Let me tell you about the arterial ulcers. Arterial ulcers are present on the toes. Can you see this is, and the lateral aspect of the foot. Can you see this lateral aspect of the foot? Had it been a neuropathic ulcer, but you will always look at the dorsum of the foot, because the pressure dependent area, this is the place where you actually develop the neuropathic ulcers. So now, can you evaluate further?
Yes, sir. Now I will move on to the examination part, palpation part of the examination. I will see for various pulsations in the leg of the patient. So first we will do it on the normal side and then we will go to the abnormal leg. And for that we have to go in serial wise from higher to the lower level. So we will start it from the femoral vessels, then we will go to popliteal vessels, then we go to dorsal spidus and later popliteal vessels. I will ask the patient to lie down.
Later, Aram sir.
So now I am starting the examination. I have taken prior consent of the patient. जांच कर सकते हैं आपकी ठीक है सो नाउ आई एम स्टार्टिंग द पल्पेशन ऑफ द फेमोरल वेसल्स एज यू कैन सी द फेमोरल वेसल्स आर लोकेटेड at below the mid-point of the inguinal ligament. So now here I can see the pubic tubercle, and here is the ASIS of the patient. So in between, this is the inguinal ligament, and now I am seeing the midpoint of the inguinal ligament, and we will go 4 cm below and 1.2 cm medial to this point to palpate femoral pulse. So here I am feeling very good femoral pulse, which means this side artery is very viable and there are no alteration in the vessel like atherosclerosis. Now I'll go to the abnormal side, because we have to do it dermatome wise. Now I am seeing on the left leg where the patient is having an ulcer. So in the same way, I am first palpating the pubic tubercle, then I am going to ASIS, then I am locating the midpoint, then I am going 4 cm below it and 1.2 cm medial to it. Now from when I palpate it here, I can feel that pulse is not as good as it present on the right leg. It means there is some amount of thickening of vessel wall, due to which I am not able to palpate the pulse exactly. So secondly, after this I will go to the popliteal vessel, which is the next group of vessels. So first I will demonstrate it in the right leg. For popliteal vessels, we have to ask the patient to flex his knee for 40 degrees, and then we will use our two finger method, where I am going to put the thumb aspect on the sheen of the patient and the patella of the patient, and all of my fingers will go deep in the popliteal fossa, and we will press it in the medial part to palpate the vessel.
Are you feeling?
Yes, sir, I am feeling. Yes, I can feel very good popliteal vessels, and it's very...
Students, this is a very important way of demonstrating. So both your thumbs over this, and then you can palpate it with the fingers. So you don't have to, you have to just feel. Yeah, a very good palpation, very good pulse is there, very good. And let me tell you one very important thing. Not only you need to assess for the pulses, you also have to assess for the brewing. So you have to use a stethoscope to examine for the brewing. So if you can show how do we examine the brewing on the abnormal side, because there could be stenosis, there could be murmurs. So you have to evaluate all these things. You can use my stetho if you want. Yes.
So now I'm going to demonstrate you the brewing on the abnormal leg. So as you can see, this is the this is the left leg in which patient is having an ulcer. Now as you can see, I am going into the popliteal fossa, and in the middle of the popliteal fossa, there is popliteal artery present. There is a slight bluey present in the left popliteal artery, which is audible, but it's not that severe bluey, but there is significant bluey.
So what are the other pulses? What are the other pulses that you are going to demonstrate to us? And what are the important ones? Tell me, what are the important ones? If you talk about the distal pulses, peripheral pulses.
In peripheral pulses, first and most important is the dorsal aspidus pulse, which is very important. And second is the posterior popliteal vessels. So now I'm going to demonstrate you the dorsal aspidus artery. For dorsal aspidus artery, first we have to locate the extensor hallucis longus tendon. As you can see, this is the tendon of the patient, and we will go medial to this, and we will palpate it by two fingers.
Very good, very good.
At this side, I can feel very good pulsation in the patient. Now I am going to the other side. So same way here, I am going to ask the patient to plantar flex his knee ankle, and I can see the extensor hallucis tendon, and now I am palpating it. But I am feeling some difficulty to locate the pulse here. It means that pulses are very febrile. It means there is significant atherosclerosis in this area.
I'll interrupt one thing here. Many a times what happens, students, you should be a bit gentle. You should not press your fingers, because this is a bony surface. Sometimes what happens, you press your fingers so firmly that you get the pulsations of your capillaries, or you can say your finger pulsation is felt here, and that is the reason you say that it's present despite the fact it may be absent. Can you show me the posterior tibial pulsations?
So for posterior tibial pulsation, we will go. It is located midway between.
You show me on the abnormal side.
Okay. It is present on the midway between the medial malleolus and the tendo Achilles. So I am demonstrating it here. I am unable to feel that pulse in this patient.
On the opposite?
I can feel it very well in the normal leg.
Okay. Thank you. That was very important. Can you tell me some other points that we should be looking for? Is there any importance of capillary refill time?
Yes, sir. Capillary refill time is usually delayed in cases of arteriosclerosis. So we will check for that as well.
Okay, I'll demonstrate you how we look for the capillary refill time. So what will you do? You will press it here. You will press for 10 seconds. Either side. Okay. You take it from this side. This side, sir. You will press it for 10 seconds. Yes. And then you will release it. So you will note the time taken by the blood, this pale tissue, to turn pink. Bache, it's more than roughly 2 seconds. Let me tell you one very important point. The normal capillary refill time should be less than 2 seconds. If it is taking more than 2 seconds, there is some delay. And more than five seconds is considered to be a sign of severe ischemia. What else would you look in this? What else? Can you describe the ulcer? Can you describe the gangrenous pattern here?
In this, we can see there is a dry gangrene. There is no infection in this patient. And the gangrene is located very well around the nail pattern and the ankle pattern.
Okay, so can you give me a differential diagnosis as what it could be?
It could be a peripheral vascular disease. It could be a varicose vein, initial progression of varicose vein, because I am seeing dilated intradermal vessels.
Okay, so you are seeing dilated intradermal vessels. Let me also see, can you focus here? Yes. There are telangiectatic vessels. Can you see? These are telangiectatic small vessels. And yes, there could be a concomitant venous insufficiency also. But prominently, as far as the history is concerned, as the examination is suggesting, this is a clear-cut case of peripheral arterial disease. And now, let us see how we can grade this. Now, this patient started with claudication. A claudication is considered to be whenever you are answering these questions, you should be, or you are writing a summary or you are writing a diagnosis, you should be very confident as far as the staging is concerned. Fontaine and Rutherford are the two types of staging. If you talk about Fontaine, Fontaine 0 is asymptomatic, 1 is asymptomatic. Fontaine 2 is a patient with intermittent claudication, which the patient is having. Fontaine 3 is a patient with rest pain, and Fontaine 4 is what? Gangrene. So can you see there is gangrene appearing at this point? So this is a case of Fontaine 4. Now I will like to ask you people, what should be the primary investigation that we should be doing so that we get to know the status of arteries and veins?
First, in the clinical examination only, we can check the ankle brachial index, which is very, very good marker of what is the degree of insufficiency.
So have you done that ABI?
Yes, sir. I have done that ABI, and the measurement of it was 0.7.
So let me tell you, the ankle brachial index means measuring the pressure, the systolic pressure of the anterior tibial artery, and comparing it with the brachial artery. A normal person has one. But remember, in case of diabetics or CRF, when there is excessive deposition of calcium over the vessel, it could be dubious. It could be more than one, despite the fact that patient is having a peripheral arterial disease. Yes, less than 0.9 is significant of peripheral arterial disease. Less than 0.7, intermittent claudication. Less than 0.5, it is suggest up to 0.3, it is suggestive of rest pain. Less than 0.3, it is a critical limb ischemia. So this patient, yes, if you are seeing it 0.7, I say that yes, the peripheral arterial disease is there. What are the radiological assessments that we should be doing for this patient? Can you tell me?
We have to check for color doctor investigation.
Very good. So I have a Doppler report also of this patient, which shows a monophasic and a biphasic flow in the arteries. The arteries should be triphasic, and it should be triphasic throughout. So this patient is showing a monophasic pattern in the ADA, anterior tibial artery also, and dorsalis pedis, as far as the posterior tibial artery. There is a blockage which is showing a block. The report is showing a block at the level of femoral artery. Now let me tell you, students, this is the initial assessment. To finalize how we have to proceed for the management, we need a CT angiography. We can do a CT, we can do a MR angiography, but CT angiography is more beneficial. Why? Because the calcification is not based on CT. So CT angiography is needed. Why? Because this patient will require a vascular bypass. Because if you don't bypass, the venous, the arterial insufficiency will lead to a progressive loss of the limb over the time. We will do definitely an amputation of the great toe, of the little finger, but this is not the solution. So ideally, we should be going for a graft and bypass graft. In this case, the blockage is at the level of femoral artery. So we will be planning an iliofemoral, or if we'll evaluate it with a CT angiography and we get to know that this patient is having a blockage at the level of iliac also, so then auto iliac or auto femoral. So that will be the type of bypasses that we will be going for. As far as bypass is concerned, if we go for a peripheral vessels, we prefer autologous graft. Saphenous is the choice. When we go to the central vessels where we involve artery or iliacs, then we need a good tensile strength graft, and that property is shown by Decron. So I hope this case discussion would be helpful for many of you, for patients, for medical students, and this is the way you should approach to a patient. I'm very helpful to the team Highland to be a participation, to help me do a case presentation. I'm very helpful to everyone. Stay connected, keep on watching these case scenarios, and definitely they will prove a milestone in your clinical practice. Thank you.